I want to invent that device that everybody can have access to, that can record smells. And I want to invent another device which can play any scent. So I want to be able to walk into my living room and smell like I'm walking through a cedar forest. The scent is so pervasive in our life, but it's completely invisible. But when you start to pay attention to what is going on in the chemical world, what information is being shared between plants and insects, between animals and insects, and what information is being detected when we are taking a whiff of someone's perfume, and a memory is being formed that lasts a lifetime, by the way. When you start to plumb into those mysteries and begin to build engineered systems that can tap into that, you actually find the application spaces are quite varied, quite wide, and quite impactful. Ultimately, I think we'll be able to sniff out disease. I think we'll be able to detect the scent of changes on the inside which get to our outside because we breathe, because we sweat, because we exude the molecules that we create inside of our skin to the outside. Scent is an incredibly potent source of information that basically is untapped right now. What I would like, and maybe this dates myself, but I would like a tricorder or a device that you can hold that can detect any smell. And it can capture the smell to be replayed, or it can tell you, hey, based on your scent or your breath, you should work out really hard today, or maybe you should go see a doctor. I want to invent that device that everybody can have access to, that can record smells. And I want to invent another device which can play any scent. So I want to be able to walk into my living room and smell like I'm walking through a cedar forest. I want to be able to watch a baking show and actually smell what they're making, right? Like, I want to bring scent into the realm of multimedia, into the realm of health, into our daily lives. The kind of brain cancer that he had many years ago had been documented as actually having a smell. And the evidence was really light, but it was enough of like a spark or a glimmer for me to really come to a belief that my father, and I think many other people, could be alive today if we had been able to invent something which could smell diseases like this early.
The ocean produces 50% of the global oxygen in the planet. It's not exactly 50% of what we breathe, that's important. It's 50% of what all life breathes in the planet. And it also absorbs 90% of excess heat. So it is extremely important for our life support systems, but it's also extremely important for our economies.
AI is really having a huge impact on performers, especially in voice work, but also in film, television, and streaming. The reason that it's hitting voice work so fast is because, of course, from a technical perspective, the requirements are less to create a realistic sounding voice through synthetic technology and artificial intelligence. But it really has raised questions about what's the future of human creativity? How can performers engage with artificial intelligence in a way that's safe for them and their future? It's not about saying, no, you can't ever do this with technology. It's about saying, if that use of technology is going to involve someone's image, likeness, voice, performance, then they should have the right to decide if that'll be brought into that technical sphere or not. And I think, of course, also compensating workers for the fruits of their labor is crucial. It's not right for companies or anyone to take someone's work or their work product and just not compensate them or treat them fairly from an economic point of view. The other key issue is, will actors be completely replaced by generative AI synthetic actors who aren't even a replica of them, that are just a replica of no one that actually exists in the world? And what would that mean for our members, for actors, and for everyone? One of the key things we've been fighting for as a union is to make sure that the playing field is level, economically speaking, between, for example, synthetic performers generated by AI and human performers. It's important to recognize we can't mitigate every impact of AI. There will be some positive impacts that AI might have, but there will also be negative impacts that even the strongest unions and the best public policy won't be able to completely prevent or eliminate. We at SAG-AFTRA, and I think others, do education to help make sure all of our members really understand what the rules are and what their rights are under these agreements and under the law. And it's not only about those who are gonna be famous, because this affects everybody from background actors all the way up to the most successful, you know, celebrity stars.
You need a spacesuit to live in the vacuum of space. So if you go outside the space station, you have to have a spacesuit on. Traditional spacesuits are big, 160 kilo gas pressurized suits. So big and bulky and not very mobile. So you waste most of your energy moving inside the suit, not doing your work that you want to do in space. we design what we call mechanical counterpressure. It's a pressurized suit, but what it does is it's not a balloon. It's not gas pressurized. It puts the pressure directly on the skin. So if I can have a second skin design, pressurized to a third of an atmosphere, it's 30 kilopascals, put that right on my skin, it's fantastic because I get lots of mobility. It's a very lightweight system. Moon is a vacuum, and you have no depth perception on the moon. Think of it as, you know, superhuman eyes, synthetic vision that we would embed in the helmet because our normal eyes are not going to be able to see depth perception. I don't know if you're 10 meters or 100 meters from me. We can't explore. But if we embed that into the helmet of the spacesuit and give that enhanced vision to the human explorers, that's what we're developing.